Professor Braidotti from the University of Utrecht needs no further introduction, and I will give her no further introduction. We've savored her eloquence and learned from her wisdom over the last two afternoons. Rüdiger Campe is the Alfred C. and Martha F. Moore Professor of Germanic Literatures, Languages and Literatures, and of Comparative Literature here at Yale. He is a distinguished scholar of German literature and philosophy, and indeed of European literature and philosophy in general, with a long bibliography to his name, taking up writing and thought from the classical period down to the 20th century, from Aeschylus to Foucault and beyond. He has garnered many awards, including a Humboldt Research Award in 2011, and he is one of the co-conveners with Francesco Cassetti and Craig Buckley of the recently launched 2017 Yale Sawyer Seminar, The Excessive Screen. Joanna Radin is an assistant professor in the History of Science and Medicine program here at Yale again, with appointments also in history and anthropology. Since completing her PhD at the University of Pennsylvania in 2012, she has, in a very short time, had a very large impact at Yale, teaching on science studies, the history of global health, bioethics, and biopolitics. In just a few weeks, her first book will be released by the University of Chicago Press, entitled Life on Ice, A History of New Uses for Cold Blood. It tells the startling story, fascinating story, and the after story down to the present day of frozen tissue samples from indigenous communities all over the world that were stockpiled after World War II in the midst of fears of nuclear annihilation. Two topics: the screen as a ubiquitous locus of mediation between embodied humans and their environmental affordances, and a collection of frozen human tissue samples first conceived as an archive of the genetic variety of the species, two topics that carry us somewhere near to the heart of the neo-materialism Professor Braidotti has spoken eloquently about in her lectures. I turn the floor over to the three of them to take the conversation where they will. They will talk for a while, and then we'll open up the floor for questions. Afterwards, there will be a light lunch in room 108 down at the end of the hall behind you. My staff is always very clear about that, the fact that I must announce these things. You are all very cordially invited, and we hope you will join us there afterwards. Thanks again for coming.
So, thank you, good morning. I will start out with thanking Rosi Braidotti for these wonderful two evenings, and this broad and rich research program, which was really what really made the deep impression on me, the design and the structure of a whole research program, which you unfolded for us. And that's, I guess, where I would like to start the conversation, in order to ask a little bit more about what animates this dynamism and inclusiveness, or the dynamic inclusiveness of this research program. And I would like to perhaps to pick up on a particular idea with which you ended yesterday, the idea of the missing people, and I bring that up because in the missing people there seems to be, I mean, for every one of us who grew up in the late 50s and 60s, missing people, displaced people, is also a name of an office, really, and looking for where is someone, and even you miss the people, but you don't even know whom you're missing. So I'm very much interested in this kind of negativity which seems to come with the idea of something, someone missing, whom we would expect to be at this place. And on the other hand, your thorough commitment to an affirmative methodology in the sense of Nietzsche. So how do these things, two tendencies, go together? And if I may, I would perhaps mention as a kind of a foil for what I see you doing, another research program which unfolded between the wars and after World War II in Europe, which has often been called philosophical anthropology, a research program based on the idea of the deficiency of man. So there is something intrinsically missing, so to speak, in the nature of man. There is an intrinsic lack of adaptation. I mean, the theme, the Lacanian scene of the premature birth is a particular variation of that. Perhaps even one could say that McLuhan's theory is still a prolongation of this idea that it is the nature of man not to have a nature, and therefore a certain kind of a biological and technological studies are coming out of the question of man. So I think that there is a certain similarity with this kind of program, but also a big difference with this program. And that was something I wanted to perhaps to bring in as a foil for my question of how is, so to speak, negativity and affirmation constellated.
Thank you so much. We really need 6 weeks to do justice to this. Questions also emerging from your own work, you know so much more about all the techno and media side of things. The two questions really got together, what motivates the dynamism, which I call my pathological optimism, and the desire for inclusiveness, and the connection between acknowledging the negativity of events, of encounters, of context, and yet holding on to the affirmative approach. And thank you for, of course, citing Nietzsche. I pitched two lectures on almost entirely on Spinoza for the sake of time, but obviously all the transmutation of values argument is part of there. And Nietzsche, of course, an eminent author that Deleuze has worked a long time on. So maybe better start from the second, because it may answer the first as well. What brought me closer to Spinozism and consequently more to Deleuze, the Deleuze without Guattari, which is a complicated choice to make in Deleuze studies. There are the vintage Deleuzians, there are the vintage Guattarians, and there are the Deleuzian Guattarians. And I tend to be more of a Deleuzian because, of course, I studied with him. The strength of that argument is that it acknowledges the importance of the negative. It is not facile optimism. The whole point of the ethics of Spinoza is to deal with the difficulties of the times. And Spinoza lived in really difficult times. He lived at the end of the Dutch Republic. He watched an entire geopolitical world order come crashing down. Sounds familiar. Watched a democracy dying, watched lynching and rounding up of people in the streets, and himself a very marginal figure, expelled from the community, living outside the city, expelled from the synagogue, managed to make himself very much persona non grata, and yet writing and working in relative isolation, in self-sufficiency. It's quite a personality. And I think that that combination of elements makes him persona non grata in the history of philosophy as well. It's really not taught as much as you ought to be. He has some elements of not the sort of radicalism that has spoken to the hearts of people like Balibar, Negri, the neo-Spinozists, that are the radical left wing of post-structuralism. So there is the acknowledgement of negativity. That is very important because there's a lot of materialism and vitalism that does not. That talks about our togetherness, our being part of the totality of things in a holistic manner that does not leave any room for conflict, for antagonism. There's a lot of that, and it's okay, it's better to be that than to be caught in the old dialectics as far as I'm concerned, but that mindless trust that every relation is good, I think is absolutely not the way I want to go with this. It's precisely not the case that every modal relation is good. You could discuss rape as a modal relation, some modal relation that is. So you need to have an index by which you can distinguish degrees of negativity. And what is the strength of Spinozism is that the ethical evil is negativity, and the ethical good is the quest and the construction of affirmation, joyful passion, he calls it, the pursuit of joy, which is connected to a state of grace, and there's a whole metaphysics behind it, but contemporary Spinozism doesn't go there, just takes it into this praxis, this effort at constructing what is a collectively shared, I call it a collectively shared social horizon of hope. But I didn't go too much into this in the paper because it's a bit heavy for a big performance, but it really is the heart of the ethics, the laboring together to rework, acknowledge, Truth and Reconciliation Commissions globally, acknowledge, yes, I raped your sister because I was angry. It's atonement for crimes and deeds for which forgiveness is unimaginable. You can take the road of somebody like Lyotard and say there are crimes and actions that are so enormous that they can never be overcome. And it becomes the question of the different, which has also been very inspirational for critical legal theory. But even Lyotard pushing this says, really, we have to accept that there's no amount of anything that can come to terms with the Holocaust or other genocide. You can only just take the responsibility, fall on your knees, and implore the heavens for forgiveness, or simply acknowledge, take it in, and rework it from there. And I think that is, it's hard work. And then why should we do it? Well, we should do it because we assume that people want to lead an ethical life, particularly people who are committed to the strange exercise that is thinking and knowing and dealing with ideas and being lifelong students of the great text, which we all are. We all come from a clerical tradition of studying the great text. I mean, we are our profession comes from that. I don't know what our future will be, but our past is clear. So that attachment, that respect for in a certain way of life. I always say to my graduate students, if you do a PhD and you choose this life, you are choosing a lifestyle. You will have a house, it will be door-to-door books. And every time I go to a non-academic house, I think, they have very, very few books. There are houses that actually have walls and not libraries. You must recognize this. So you are choosing a location in life. Mm-hmm. So I think that is the strength. And of course, it's part of a big debate. Hegel was not convinced. Badiou is not convinced. Zizek is not convinced. And they say this is, you know, holistic fluff, because proper negativity is the dialectics that position negativity as the fundamental motor of the whole exercise. What triggers the energy in a Hegelian Marxist scheme is that oppositional. You've got your sparring partner, thesis, antithesis, synthesis, that creates the energy, and out of it we get the motivation to act. Spinoza has a totally different scheme. He assumes that we are ontologically positive people, right, that left to ourselves, we can actually handle things pretty well. So he is very much in disagreement with the social contract theories that assume that man in nature is a wolf to other man. Not for Spinoza, yes, for Hobbes. But he says man in nature is doing perfectly fine. The state comes in and complicates things, creates rules and regulations. So that's why he's a radical Republican, saying only the people can decide what mode of government is good for them. We all read the Spinozas, but the theological political treaty of Spinoza, we all read the ethics, but the theological political treaty is what Balibar Negri really take off from. It's very, very radical thinking, radical democracy, really. But he assumes that we are ontologically good, so to speak, and that, of course, you can imagine in a Christian Calvinist context does. And I think that is sometimes the reason why he's dismissed as a mindless optimist. But that profound goodness is, again, not psychological, it's an ontological side. We gravitate towards the pleasure of persevering in our existence. And then all, of course, negativity surrounds us, and the ethical life is in reworking it. And cultivating relations and alliances and lifestyles, we would say today, that enhance that ability. But it's hard work. And it doesn't, you know, although we gravitate towards it, it's not as if it's not spontaneity. And I think that reading of Spinoza, which has been done, for instance, in the first Gaia generation, where it is read holistically, all that lives is holy, la la la. It's a little bit simple. Mm. I think he knows how difficult this is and why we need to make it a task, so to speak.
I will give to you in a moment. I would like to come back to that at a later point. I'm really fascinated now how you explain the Spinoza's position, also with regard to the we, which plays such a big role in your in what you unfolded to us in the last 2 days. That is a we that is not constituted in a contract-like sense of I and you, and now we have to do something in order to get together, wherever it comes from, but that this we, in a certain way, is a pre-constituted we, which already exists and you have to take it on. So perhaps that's something, I mean, perhaps one can also say, I mean, that's a 17th century Spinoza before the bourgeois century, the century of contractualism, where all our relations are based on a negotiations between subjects.
I think he's also an artisan in an age of already for the Dutch venture capitalism and the empire is
absolutely
up and running, and
he's
actually an artisan working manually, but technologically. He's an extremely interesting figure. Yeah. I think it's Isaiah Berlin, Jonathan Israel, that does justice to him in the Dark Enlightenment, the other Enlightenment, the Dutch Enlightenment. Where you have the centrality of the Spinozist moment. But I think you need to bring it, I mean, the Deleuzian method is you don't respect the sacred monsters of the history of philosophy, you bring them into the 21st century. I think we need a distinction between the actual and the virtual. Mm-hmm. Yes, the we is already there, but it isn't. It's something that you need to recompose, and the mode of composition is affective and ethical. We gravitate around certain concerns. In some ways, the Anthropocene at this point is a matter of faith. You believe in it or not. It was just this morning, I think, in the Yale newspaper, one of your leading scientists, sorry to mention this, it's a bit impolite, but on climate denial, climate change denial. So it's a matter at this point, you almost throw a dice. So you need to gravitate around people, says actually the evidence is overwhelming, the ice cap is melting, species are dying, even if it will pass, 300 years from now, right now it looks bad. And from there, then you start, and that composition is a way of becoming active, but processing multiple hurdles of negativity. I mean, it hurts when scientists, for me anyway, deny what seems so obvious. You think, how can you do that? And there is disappointment and there is resentment. So the processes are multi-layered. And Deleuze does it very well because then Guattari comes in with his new psychoanalysis, schizoanalysis, and has all the internal mechanisms for detoxing our dependence on negativity. It is a fact that so much of critical theory is simply merchandising on the negative. We're against, we oppose, we claim, we want recognition. It's that dialectical mode. And of course, this is the emancipatory logic. We need to do that, but not only. And the actual transformative process requires that you go beyond that. And you say, okay, then what do we do? How do we do it? In what terms and what means? And dealing with the opposition, not chastising them as the devil in a dialectical mode that says, when a revolution comes, back to the wall. I still have friends in Britain, particularly. When the revolution comes, back to the wall. That's how we deal with people that we disagree with. I don't actually think so. I think we need to negotiate and talk and continue, and in different degrees and different. But also critical theory then becomes creation of work. I call them the shareable workbenches, because I really want the university to remain in these conversations. I don't want to just drop out and be just an activist. I'm trying to bridge two things.
That's actually a beautiful opening to the kinds of questions that I wanted to ask in the realm of praxis, and to maybe just do a little bit of situating myself and where I'm coming from as someone who's trained in the history and sociology of science and science studies. And here at Yale, I occupy an interesting space where my appointment is in a medical school. And so in many ways, I wrestle with these philosophical questions on a very daily basis around people who are struggling to think about what it means to care for the human in a very material sense, and are struggling to also understand what does it mean, what is that human to whom care is given. And I've been thinking as this conversation has been unfolding about phenomena that I've been registering as I move through different kinds of communities in science studies, anthropology of science, history of science, science studies, that are deeply engaged with your work and the kinds of questions that you and allied scholars are asking. And many of my students are in the audience today, and we talk a lot about what does it mean to, what does praxis mean? What does it mean to put this into praxis, into practice? What does this kind of ethic involve? And you know, the Anthropocene has become a kind of organizing, it has its own seemingly self-organizing principle of the virtual and the practical, but I was thinking in particular when you were responding to Rüdiger right now about a workshop that the graduate students organized last weekend called Critical Histories and Activist Futures that was really trying to wrestle with the problem of racial violence and science and medicine's struggle to register that. And one of the questions, and I don't know that they necessarily, and they may have questions or things they'd like to ask you, but they struggled very deeply with the question of who is we? We are all in this together, but we are not one. And the practical challenges of trying to forge a collective that does not compound the violence, yet can create space for a what we might call a positive knowledge project that you are so gratefully promoting, which is something that I think many of us are reaching for. How do we constitute a positive knowledge project without abandoning the critical facilities, without abandoning the sort of philosophical grounding that helps orient us within the institution? And I wondered if you had thoughts. You gestured to a number of really evocative examples in your lectures, but I'm curious to know more of your sense of to take the post-human condition and really make it something that we have to reckon with and help us realize how to be attentive to it. What advice do you have for us? And it could be, it doesn't have to be, it could be mundane or it could be expansive, but your teachings are so crucial for the moment that we're in. And I would love to invite you to use some of this space to expand upon that in both your kind of concrete institutional endeavors, but also in your thinking and your writing.
Very gracious, thank you. Extremely important, extremely interesting. Complicated again. I gave some examples as I went towards the end by saying that the emergence of the missing people is an ongoing process. I'm sure that in the space of the last few days, a couple more branches of the critical humanities were invented and several studies. One already, this will go down in my history, one here from Yale on the chickens called avian and area studies, but it's about chicks. So that process goes on, and I think what we need and what I saw my task at this particular point is that meta-methodological, it's like a computer game, and we try to set up the rules considering that all of this is going on, if we agree, because here is the composition of the we. If you are convinced, even hypothetically, by the case that I'm making, that there is not a fragmentation of humanity's knowledge, but a rhizomic proliferation of new areas of studies that are crossing major borders, if, then we have a scholarly community, also activist and ethically motivated, that can test this and see what the consequences are. The first platform on which I went testing this was the pedagogics, education, that I did with my research groups in South Africa. Of course, the Netherlands and South Africa have a long tradition, a long history. And so the idea of post-apartheid education, the introduction of the new technologies, the whole weight of negativity of that history, and how do we move on. Extremely interesting stuff. Achille Mbembe is also a bit around there, a lot in Duke, but a lot in Johannesburg. It's a very strong critical theory tradition, and they have, of course, the historical model of the Truth and Reconciliation Commissions, which, however controversial, is one of the great historical models of actually having it out and having out things which are not simple or easy. I can't imagine that, for instance, in the situation of the Balkans and the Balkan War in Europe. I don't think where the shadow of the Second World War, as well as the post-89 events, and caused so much human suffering and disasters. So they have all of that, the pedagogics of how do we do this. And it seems to be happening more easily, this level of discussion, in relatively new marginal universities than in the big research university. The example that I always give is Linköping, that was mentioned in Sweden, where they have the Posthumanities Hub that has generated the Environmental Humanities Hub, which is now splitting into a few other things, and intense investments from the national government. Mm. They got millions for it. Another example would be the Anthropocene example of Germany, with the Haus der Kultur der Welt, the Deutsche Museum, von Humboldt, 50 million euros the first time, 60 million euros the second time, 300 PhDs. How do we think the Anthropocene? Go on the website, artists and researchers, activists, every scholar imaginable. And now with the technosphere, much more emphasis on the technological composites and of that. Again, massive investment. The counterexample would be Oxford. Oxford that has embraced transhumanism in an institute, you can Google it, the Institute for the Future of Humanity, because, hey, this is Oxford, we're not messing around here. And the Institute for the Future of Humanity, run by a very, very brilliant man by the name of Nick Bostrom, does posthumanism as transhumanism. And millions. I mean, he got the ERC, he got just, it's a place to get jobs, so look at it, I admire enormously. Cambridge answered immediately with the Center for the Assessment of Existential Risk, run by my good friend Hugh Price, Bertrand Russell, professor of philosophy. We went to school together at the ANU. Money from Skype, again, very well funded. So between Oxford and Cambridge, that's like the regatta, they sort of share out the work. But Oxford has gone for transhumanism, and the project is exactly what you were mentioning before. The human being is not adapted. We are really, our organisms are a little bit obsolete, and our brains are slower than the computational networks that we have created. There's the famous perception gap. Now, that is a problem, because it means the major decisions are being made by the computational networks. And two, to mention just two, the Wall Street one, the financial one, and the defense one. It was 18 months or so ago that the Wall Street computers went down, the famous blackout of Wall Street. For 20 minutes, there was no global economy. Then they self-repaired, and they came up again, but they self-repaired. And then we went back, and we could track what had gone wrong, but you can only do it a posteriori. Now, this worries the transhumanist of Oxford and Nick Bostrom. So what the answer is very simple: enhancement. We have to speed up, folks. Project is called Superintelligence, Neurosciences, Robotics, Analytic Philosophy, and Cognitive Neurosciences. Through enhancement and new interfaces with the computers, we will be ready for work. This is not science fiction, it's Oxford today. It's number two or three in the world, I don't know, just along or below Yale, millions of investment, incredible amount of PhDs. This is what I mean that we are not, this is why I don't agree that the posthuman is to come. It's right here. And decisions are being made that are very, 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 I think, significant. And Bostrom is a very erudite, extremely clever man. And what he does is analytically is a complete posthumanist. We acknowledge that the human brain is not as good as the computing, or not as fast, so we enhance it. So post-anthropocentrism. When it comes to the norms and values, he retreats back to the Enlightenment and says, what I'm doing here is achieving the perfectibility of man through science and technology, which is what the 18th century wanted us to do, n'est-ce pas? Well, I don't read the 18th century as actually intervening, but it's a so very heavy doses of neo-Kantian universalism, and the new man will be, but without any, this is why in my posthumanist, just a moment, what is this man? Because this is being reconstituted as we speak, And I would be surprised if Yale was any different from this. So the institutional examples give us a hint of where we need to go. That's why the first level that I took was the didactic, saying, well, actually, we need to question this. And they, of course, can always pretend that all the knowledge produced by the studies is second rate.
Right.
And if you leave the studies out, you don't have a differential, grounded but differential way of talking about this human. That's why I think it's crucial to reappraise the incredible cognitive contribution of those marginal study areas that have been dealing with this and in an emancipatory, at times oppositional mode, but we've been dealing with it for decades. So this is one crucial one. The other one is what I talked a bit about yesterday, various experiments with land rights and alliances with indigenous because of my Australian existence.
Please, I would like to invite you to talk more about that because that, to my mind, is that having spent time thinking about, in a very material sense, what happens when indigenous people's blood is collected, right, and then yields new sorts of possibilities, but also is meant to be reclaimed. So there's a narrative where indigenous peoples are disappearing, and we civilized, you know, or cosmopolitan scientists are maladapted, and indigenous peoples are closer to nature, closer to the land, and their bodies are going to be resources for us, not their knowledge, but this is changing. And indigenous peoples, in their metaphysics and their philosophy, there's the kind of radical interconnection that you are arguing for, but with the additional dimension of relationship to land and place. And I would just really love for you to speak more about the horizons of your work and how you see where you're heading and where you think that indigenous philosophy, indigenous thought has a role to play in this pushback against a recapitulation of an ideal kind of human that continues to exclude and produce missing peoples.
What a great question. Do you want to come in, Rüdiger?
Yeah, perhaps to supplement what you're saying, I mean, I think the I would be very interested in the relation between the, to come back to this formula, between the we and the in this. In a certain way, I think the interpretation you are suggesting is that this in this is something like something like a life world, something like a primary habitat in which the we in which the we occurs,
When you say primary habitat,
I'm saying that for the following reason, because I think that and I would find that very fascinating. That would be a very interesting and important interpretation. At the same time, in this can also mean in this very particular situation in which we are. In this moment, and this has also the ring of meaning either in this moment of chance, in this moment of danger, in this moment. So it's so
that to be defined as open slots you put in the project. Of course.
What I find interesting is that this we in this has a relationship between the way in which we live, our way of living, and a situation in which this through which this living is, so to speak, determined, or through which this living is framed for us. Mm-hmm. And this can be, so to speak, something in that sense primary, as we think the life world comes before our technologies, it comes before our skills and so on.
No,
and on the other hand, it can also be a very specific task given to us. And this play between something, we are in this situation, and this situation is given to us, and we have to do something in this situation, and that's what it is about. That is something which I would find interesting to explore what kind of relationship that is and where that where that occurs.
I deliberately left and the we and the this open, that it could be any, and within that we need to slot in whatever the project happens to be. So you already made your project there extremely interesting, with the techno angle, of course.
Right. I agree. That's what I'm suggesting.
Very German. I love it. But the French would do it differently.
I know.
Long tradition of this. But it's very interesting. You see that you could slot in different scheme, different cartographies of what the this actually is. But to come back to your question, I am very, very careful, of course, with the with the indigenous epistemology issue, because I'm not a specialist, nor am I an anthropologist that goes in, or in your case, I think you went and actually collected material. Practice is that
I was interested in the way in which this blood, as a historian, how this blood came to figure as an archive. I am not
a
scientist.
So we're in a similar position. I think it's very important to sort of, again, the rules of the games. On the one hand, it's absolutely true that my next project will be Posthuman and Indigeneity, together with Simon Bignall in Australia and Margaret Somerville and a whole group of, of constituency. That's coming, because I think it's absolutely where to go. On the other hand, until now, the experience has been very careful. When I worked, for instance, on the Australia and the British Columbia example, there were very eminent specialists of indigenous studies, professors of Aboriginal studies, with a history, particularly the Australian ones are really strong because many, many of them are from the lost generation, and they carry that pain, and they carry that knowledge, and they have really overcome it to the extent that they can really articulate it into another vision for Australian science. And
that's right.
And they even are a little bit, Beth Povinelli is doing great, great work, but sometimes she sort of bypasses them and goes straight in, which is sometimes perceived as a little bit rash. I love Beth's work, but they're very careful because it's their land, it's their stories. So I rely on their knowledge, and the game consists in finding the margins of negotiations. We bring to the project our respect, it's pretty classical in some respect, creating an alliance where we can zoom in on, for instance, what does it mean to accept a posthuman condition of which they see the consequences daily as the mining companies continue to steal more land and to desecrate more sacred grounds. What does it mean to be confronted by this posthuman when you've never been human, and the inhumanity confronts you in this case?
Not only when you've never been human, but when you never wanted to be the kind of human.
And that's complicated if you're a professor of Aboriginal studies at the University of Western Sydney, because you are a professor of Aboriginal studies.
That's right.
So, and if you do the feminist policy of location, which they do, and practice the materialism of immanence, these are scholars. So, but this is why then what my real answer to your question is, what really matters is the level of subjectivity. And this is what I would say to the students as well. Each one of us is many missing people. This is what the nomadic subject scheme is, the background to the posthuman.
Yes.
If you think you're only one, we cannot have this conversation. You are non-unitary. And you are not black on Wednesday, a gay on Tuesday, and as a PhD student on Friday. You're all of those things all of the time, in 1,000 plateaus of internal complexities. Becoming a scholar, but I would say becoming a functioning ethical adult, means choreographing those inner complexities, pitching them to the feasibilities of projects that you can actually implement. Trust me, you will not be able to do all of it. Because the complexities, you can live them, you can experience, you can be loyal to them. When it comes to the scholarly practice, unfortunately, depth, accuracy, focus will make you say, okay, I do this plateau, I do this slither, which does not mean that you deny all the others. And you can choreograph your inner complexities. But to get to the level that Yale expects of you, you're going to have to say, okay, I do this one. It doesn't mean that I betray the other ones, but maybe later, when the academy would have recognized the importance, for instance, of writing differently. If we were allowed to experiment with writing at the scholarly level, writing evocatively, intensively, not being held by what I consider rather antiquated rules of linearity, objectivity, clarity. If we could write like my despised teachers are writing, complicated, confrontational, multiplying language that makes you jolt up and say, either this is garbage or this is genius. What is it? But it has woken you up. It has it has dragged you out of your reading habits. You can't speed read the great philosopher. You really can't. And they do it on purpose. Every word is there to make you go, what? Like, oops, I haven't seen you before. What are you? Intensity. And you're woken up. Acceleration.
I'm so happy this is being recorded so that I can play that back at the beginning of
I had a thing on jargon yesterday, because when I hear some of my very distinguished colleagues in physics. I don't understand a word. They're off saying for, and everybody claps a genius. You do that in the ordinary language of the humanities, people say jargon. This is what I say, it's so important. I think it's our problem that we work with ordinary language, but we have to do extraordinary work. It's in a nutshell, I think, the challenge of the humanities today. And if people could accept that we also speak code, that we also have formula, that we are highly specialized scholars. It happens that the language that we speak reminds people of ordinary language. It isn't. It's extraordinary language. Mm-hmm. And that would be a culture of mutual respect. Mm-hmm. But we don't have a culture of mutual respect, so they have specialized language, we have jargon. Right. And I think that has to go. And some more freedom in experimenting with writing. And I know there are pedagogical experiments, for instance, to do PhDs online and not on paper. So you would have multiple links. Now that would allow for 1,000 plateaus of PhD writing. Then you could have your links and you could at least not have to choose one mm-hmm. plateau and have a couple, and you could then resonate with the multiple ecologies of belongings, I think. And it must be, I mean, medicine has a dramatic history in terms of race, but also sexual difference or gender, mm-hmm. Class, they've got a few things to answer for. But if I can say one wonderful thing about my university, my beloved university, Utrecht is, and I was telling you yesterday, has a very interesting experiment, which is called the One Health Movement. We have one of the first chairs in the world, if not first, that combines human and animal health, mm-hmm. veterinary mm-hmm. science and medicine together. It's called mm-hmm. One Health, and it's about epidemics. This is why I think Richard with his chickens was very interested in it. And it's about all the diseases that we share with animals, both in what used to be agriculture, mm-hmm. food, and in pets. And yes. I'm very, very proud of this. And the One Health Movement is gathering amazing. Momentum. The Dutch would do that, wouldn't they? and they do it with great ease. The human-animal connection is normal. And then you try to translate this in the language of the humanities, and people freak out immediately. What do you mean, human and animal together? So again, the humanism, the anthropocentrism, and the ease with which people that are deal with the presence, epidemics connect us to a number of animals. Absolutely. We share from the cows to the chickens are major carriers. And et cetera, et cetera. So I think there are moments like this where you see that it is actually in yes. the making, and the Oxford Institute is in the making, and then you turn around and you look at the humanities and you think, oops.
So you mentioned, there's so much here that I just think is wonderful, and this One Health is a beautiful example of the kind of thing that Yale could potentially cultivate between its medical school and its Science Hill, and maybe there are things in the work already, I suspect there are. You mentioned something earlier, which struck a particular chord with me, which is science fiction, right? This is not science fiction. And I've been teaching about science fiction as an experiment into these other ways. How do you shock people into realizing the strangeness of the familiar, mm-hmm. what they've taken for granted? And I wondered, as a kind of literature, as a kind of a missing, it's its own missing kind of people, the fictional people of science, or the alternative kinds of possibilities of humans or non-humans that could exist. And I wondered if you could speak about that, because I think especially the transhumanism, you are absolutely right. We regard it as science fiction at our own peril, without asking why is this the vision of how we must adapt. And so I'm certain you've thought about this, and if you could reflect.
Well, the answer, I think, as far as the transhumanists are concerned, it's what industry, a corporate world likes. I mean, it's immediately capitalizable within cognitive capitalism. The robotics industry, and robotics is the frontier. Artificial intelligence needs that, and that's fine. God, I'm in love with all of this. It's not an anti-science, but yeah. It is a formula that we need to critique. But to come back to science fiction, I think it's crucial. Metamorphoses, the second volume in my trilogy on nomadism, has long chapters on mm-hmm. it. And it's a fascinating field. I'm not as well versed in it as somebody like Donna Haraway, who is an embodiment of science fiction. She knows it all. I've read all the Cold War mm-hmm. and seen the Cold War. If you don't know the Cold War science fiction, you really have, looking at the millennials, take an afternoon to look at Tarantula or Them or the Shrinking Woman, the Shrinking Man and the Expanding Woman, because the model is always the same. The bomb falls. And when the bomb falls, all sort of horrors happen. So white men shrink, and while women expand. So the attack of the 50-foot woman. It's extraordinarily funny. So that's all through the 1560s. It's wonderful. I think Tarantula is the one that everybody knows. Then comes, you know, after the nuclear, after Hiroshima and Nagasaki, sort of a different consciousness, and then comes modern science fiction with biology, et cetera, et cetera. The connection here is that, indeed, science fiction is about alternative worldviews, alternative lives, always been. It's about survival. And it has always been a reservoir of ideas and blueprints for a number of radicals. I think in my political culture, feminism, gender, LGBT, science fiction has always been what I would call an anthropological exodus. It's the exit route. Get me out of here. Apart from the fact that we know that a lot of people believe in alien abduction. But I think in the political wing is not about it. It's about finding ways of escaping what we've got. And as far back as the nuclear era, but certainly by the 70s and 80s, I'm thinking of the work of Marlene Barr. There is a real equation that is at work, whereby people are postulating political social alliances between the empirically marginalized infrahumans, the blacks and the women and the LGBTs and the poor, animals and exploited non-humans, and extraterrestrials, together united against the empire of white men. That's a real equation. And Marlene Barr has that, and then Barbara Creed picks this up in the 1990 with the monstrous feminine, and the idea of the monster from outer space and that comes and crushes this planet, which is anthropological exodus and a form of disidentification. Mm-hmm. Why would I fight for this planet when this planet and this culture treats me like this? It's disidentification, anthropological exodus on the critical side, but on the affirmative side, alternative blueprints. Mm-hmm. And it goes really berserk. And Octavia Butler that does this with blackness and the race issue and all the Afrofuturism that comes. Afrofuturism is phenomenal in this. A real forerunner in our posthuman glossary that we just edited. There's a wonderful entry on it, really, really important. They go berserk on possible alternatives. And they are mostly about reproduction and sexuality. And here again, Barbara Creed picks it up, and then Jack Halberstam and contemporary queer in humanism picks it up, which is phenomenally funny. It is about alternative sexuality, alternative reproductions. If you've seen the classics, that is the Alien trilogy, which is in fact a trilogy of four, so it's not a trilogy, the Aliens movies from the 80s and 90s, they really are must. Because they are all about this. You get babies growing from trees, from pods. You've got monstrous mother machines. You've got Sigourney Weaver pronouncing the anti-Oedipal formula, mother you bitch, which made history. Oops, sorry about that. But it is a moment. There's a huge scholarship. I think the Aliens films would be where this comes to a crux before, really, we get to synthetic biology in a different phase of our knowledge of the genes. So that idea of alternative sexuality, alternative reproductions, as both a critique and a reservoir, I think that's completely still up and running and today with the imagination and the means that we have on the internet. And I think it's a very alive, very, I think it speaks to the millennial, but we just need to, again, I would like to bring it back to the fact that in reality we live in a world where gene splitting, gene editing, three-parent families are already here. So maybe we could use science fiction as a blueprint for new kingship systems and new models of kingship that I think we've been discussing in feminism for decades. And maybe we can borrow some of the imagination of the extraterrestrials to have families disconnected from the Oedipal phallologocentric traditional format and that is still a dominant. So I think a reservoir, but we have to be careful because it is so popular that in some ways, and a lot of our graduate students take it for granted, instead of taking a little bit of distance and say, you know, in some ways, reality has actually overwhelmed and overcome this. And the only thing is that our norms and values have not. To go back to the example of Oxford, we have this incredible technology, and then we bring back the neo-Kantian universalism because we're not able to invent anything else. Right. This is does not do justice to the complexity of the we are not the same.
So we need to innovate in the realm of our ethics and our vision of the human, just as much as we need to innovate in our tools and our technologies.
Spoken like a chief. It's exactly right.
Yeah, I mean, echoing this question about what would be your advice for the humanities here and in general. I mean, one can make the argument that what we think today about under the heading of humanities is in fact not something, so to speak, older or precedent to the sciences, but rather a reaction to the sciences, at least in a particular way of thinking about the humanities. One could make the argument what we today call the humanities is something which maybe originated with someone like Vico in the 18th century, who responded to Descartes. Then comes 19th century German Geisteswissenschaften responding to the psychological laboratory. And then comes, if I may include media studies already in post-structuralism, absolutely, post-structuralism press media studies responding to a particular setup in the technology of our media environments. So all these are reactions towards something which at least is perceived as a unity of the science, of a scientific method, and of some way to responding to that. And the humanities, so to speak, have their own unity only as a mirror of what they perceive as their other, the science. At least even someone like Dilthey says, there is no such thing like the Geisteswissenschaft, that's why it's a plural. We have this and this and this and that. It's all in a specific way different from what the sciences do. So there is an intrinsic relationship, and what I think what we are doing today is to step out of this only reactionary mode and try to make this reaction a part of what we are doing. Yeah? Not so much we now try to unite in the face of the other, but we make this relationship to the other exactly what we are doing. So this relationship to science as our other becomes, so to speak, a moment in what we are doing. And maybe we are all doing that in different ways. Mm-hmm. So maybe we are all in this together, but not the same, is perhaps the definition of the humanities.
Yeah. I mean, what I might say, to bring it actually really concretely to Yale and what's happening, is that, so, you know, we have continued to operate, and Latour said this when he came with this idea of the C.P. Snow's The Two Cultures, and I think that is more alive than many of us would care to admit. And this is a very interesting moment to as a student and scholar of science and technology from the humanistic perspective at Yale, when there's a major STEM initiative happening to try to figure out how to strengthen and reimagine science, technology, engineering, and medicine at Yale. And so it's many of us in history of science and history of medicine are watching and hoping to participate with enormous interest, because it precisely seems like a chance to demonstrate that we're not dealing with an other, and that we need to constitute ourselves as the against the other, but that there is enormous potential, exactly what Professor Braidotti has been saying, of enacting the reconstitution that we all see and experience materially in our lives, rather than continuing to participate. And I personally don't feel that this is a threat to the humanities. I feel like this is an incredible opportunity for the humanities. And moreover, perhaps for Yale to be innovating at the zone of what a new, you've been very helpful in giving us this is what Oxford's doing, this is what Cambridge's doing, this is what Utrecht's doing. I'm eager to see what we can do here at an institution where we've been having so many really exciting conversations about these intersections and these relationships. So I might phrase it a bit differently, yeah. But I think we are reached the same conclusion.
I wouldn't presume to give any advice to this incredible university that stands up in the heavens as a temple of excellence. I would have to learn a lot more about it apart from my great admiration for it. But it is absolutely true that it cannot be this oppositional to culture model, and it has not been so. I tried to say it yesterday when I did the genealogy of the different science, the studies generation, that each one of them has its own relationship to the sciences of the day, and media studies is the crucial, the big change is there, and the biogenetic, but media is more directly present in the humanities, and it really, I think we need to start from mediation, as the new ontology is the techno ontology. If we don't start from that, we don't belong to this century, and it does not just mean digitizing the sources, it means actually understanding what it means to be a virtual creature online. But each, from science studies, environmental studies, post-colonial studies, they all have something to say about science. And the converse is also true, and I also said it yesterday, that the sciences borrow from literature and the arts to name their ridiculous protocols of algorithmic behavior.
Or even from the surgical robot is the chimeras, Da Vinci robot.
Chimeras in biology. So the borrowing is extensive. I have my colleagues coming into the humanities saying, I have all the data, can you please give me the interpretation? I says, well, and it's not just metaphors in science, it's a far more complex set of interaction. I think that can be seen just, good collaborative ethics, but we need to bring it into the discussion, foregrounding how intense and productive the interaction is. And I think the fact that the money is in STEM, of course, in sense of where cognitive capitalism wants to go, is forcing everybody to go there, but they really cannot do it without us in some ways. I think we have to also be extremely realistic about what is happening more globally. There is a great concern, and I share with Gary Tomlinson a seat in the board of an international organization, the CHCI, that is looking at what is happening to the humanities globally. It doesn't look good. Japan shut down 28, was it, faculties last year? We know what this administration is doing at the European Commission. The funding for the humanities is shrinking as we speak. So what is that all about? This public perception that we should remain as a teaching field, but not as a research one. And the charges that our anthropocentrism make us unfit for a century where it is so obvious that everything is computational, informational networks, and biogenetic ones. And here we come with, Homo universalis, and it looks like we are really out of it. And yet, it's a great tradition that we don't want to give up. It's that game. I am also involved in the World Humanities Council, which is a new organization that has been set up by UNESCO. It's a really interesting exercise. It's an organization that was set up in 1948 by Levi-Strauss and all the great names of the post-war period attached to UNESCO, but didn't do very much. The sister organization is called the ISS, the International Social Science Councils, and they've been very active. But the Humanities Councils, in spite of Malraux and Sartre, didn't do a thing. And all of a sudden, they're walking up and they say, we are the World Council of the Humanities. They're doing the first World Humanities Conference, extremely difficult to organize. I'm on the steering committee to try also to learn. But who is the president of the organization that has revived this 1948 Levi-Strauss, André Malraux organization that went to sleep and suddenly woke up? The People's Republic of China. With an elected treasurer from Brazil, an intense interest, to cut it shortly, from the BRICS. Okay? United States, nowhere in sight. Britain, nowhere in sight. Oh, the United States is not a member of UNESCO, so we are very busy bringing in the Americans and CHI, saying we're all in this together. But it's an example of where, of course, China has enormous interest in the humanities, in their own perception of the humanities, attached to a very explicit message that democracy is not the model. Explicit. explicit. It's not Steve Bannon's cryptic, Machiavellian, dark vision. It's an explicit, the humanities and democracy is not really. Humanities and tradition, humanities and Confucianism, humanities and meritocracy. So a huge debate about what we're all about. Mm-hmm. So I would say that these are the moments where you see that the stakes are very high, mm-hmm. and that our long tradition, of which Yale will be a splendid example of connecting whatever we do with all of our difference, what different degree of adherence to the canon or disidentification from the canon, all of those differences notwithstanding, we have been the place where thinking and democracy and criticism have been forged across the so-called Western world. And if on that point, I retreat into basic humanistic principle. And I would say if we stand for anything, is that connection, that, mm-hmm. that democracy is about disagreeing, it's about arguing it, not fighting it out, not shooting it out. And it's about allowing the students to prove that the professor was wrong, which is unimaginable in any Confucian system, and about having these conversations globally. And I think that is where, as a European looking as sort of across the border, I put my hope. But obviously the stakes are high, and what counts as the humanities, there's a lot of concern about how we do that, and that should make us feel how precious and important we are.
Thank you. Okay.
This has been fantastic so far. Now we want to get you all involved. If you have questions, you need to come to one of the microphones.
Thank you both. Amazing. We have to stay in touch on the indigeneity.
Please.
We have to stay in touch on it. Because I may work with Van Humboldt. I may have a little base in Berlin. Yeah. I switched from London to Berlin because of Brexit. So I'm taking a visiting in Berlin instead. I don't want to be in that mess. Hello.
Thank you. The technological abilities there, great. What about writing? To return to the 17th century for a minute, when will this be in written form, or is it already, or available for study?
Sorry,
are you developing a book?
Yes. Well, I have to write this up, yes. what about writing and what the next writing project is?
I mean, is this already available in a book, your talk? Or?
I think I have 2 months to turn it into a book if I look at my host. I think all the tenors become books, and then we have to see to what an extent and how far I go with it. And then the next project would be the Posthuman Indigeneity, one that I'm doing as a collaborative project.
And that's a ways away, another year.
We already have quite a few essays. It's an edited volume, so we would push on, because it's always been part of the practice. I think I even mentioned it in this book mm-hmm. somewhere, but it, as usual, you can't do it all, the linearity and the plateaus. But I think writing is something that I would also throw in our conversation with the students, and you write eminently also as a poet, so compliments for that. But to reflect about what we do when we write. And I think it's something that my teachers did extremely well, because they were very tuned in to language, being the children of structuralism, of Saussure and Jacobson, and I think of what Bach does mm-hmm. with the space of writing. I think we haven't reflected enough about what you do when you write, and what in an academic setting, but with all the stuff that we bring to it, and we are the missing people, we are in this together, how to bring on the multiplicity, the multi-layeredness of subjectivity in the space of writing in an acceptable academic manner. And I said I had both the best and the worst of teachers, because my teachers took on writing head on, and they made language do monstrous things, and, which cost them dearly, because people thought they were wacko, and a lot of it is lost in translation. But I think that they did it deliberately to say language is not transparent. Language is not a means of communication. Language speaks you. You are spoken by structures, by terminologies, by mm-hmm. syntaxes, by traditions that you will never master. The idea that you master it is a good academic ideal, but it's not really achievable in this. So what I took as my model is always the pages of Deleuze in the in the dialogues when he talks about the superiority of Anglo-American literature, for instance, and how language simply is a line of flight that connects you to intensities, or the way he speaks about Virginia Woolf, who is, Virginia Woolf is like, I'm speechless every time I think of Virginia Woolf. What a planet, what an intensity. And is the one writer that Deleuze continuously quotes, but when he does his literary essays in that wonderful collection called Essays Critical and Clinical, where he has Melville, he has Kafka, he does not have a chapter on Virginia Woolf. He can't do it. It's like Freud on the enigma of femininity. It just can't do it. But the idea of writing intensively, writing intransitively, writing without an object, writing like breathing, writing as a mode of existence. And I think a lot of us, even the most code-oriented, are sort of closeted graphomaniacs. I would challenge you on this. Even the millennials, we just love writing, don't we? We still have booklets, don't we? And we select them very carefully, probably with color codes. And if you're smiling and recognizing this, then you will know, even you, the cyber notes of the millennial generation, that there is something about writing intransitively, writing as a mode of being, that is probably the reason why we're in the humanities and not writing code, although we can also write code to pay our rent. But the real thing is, so I think the reflection on this, without going into the complexities of the post-structuralism deconstruction, because that may take us where we don't want to go, but keeping some of the sensitivity to that, because if we describe the activity of thinking as the invention of new concepts, that creativity has to come from our own relationship to language. And all of us have that closeted graphomaniac, I have my notebook sort of thing, and we recognize each other in trains or in coffee shops because there is the laptop, but there is also the booklet.
Yeah. And I think that's why it's so important that a part of the project is a project about what it means to write and speak in particular languages. I mean, Spinoza writing in Latin is something very different from us writing today in English, or some people speaking not their own language here on the podium, and others do. I mean, to understand, so to speak, the ecology of languages is, I think, something which hasn't really been formulated as a product. Sorry, but I was enthusiastic about what you said.
I'd like to continue the discussion of language. And I want to thank everybody for a really exhilarating and stimulating and provocative discussion so far. My field is Yiddish, so I don't really belong anywhere.
No.
So that means I can kind of belong everywhere. But I was particularly beguiled by the conversation about, the humanities has jargon. The science has, sciences have terminology. The word for Yiddish in the 19th century, before Yiddish was called Yiddish, was jargon.
Really?
Heard it here first, folks. Which is to say that nothing disempowers a language more than calling it a jargon. And I think that what your exchanges have clarified for us in the interface between science and humanities in a global economy is a question of power. And we see the status of the human, and we see the value of humanities as a field of research being steadily downgraded. And I guess the question is, or the challenge is, for those of us, looking not only for, institutional reasons, but maybe also for personal reasons, how do we address this imbalance in semantic power? And how is what we do, how do we elevate the cultural capital of what we do in an increasingly post-human, technological, cybernetic economy?
Fantastic question. Thank you so much. And what amazing piece of information, jargon. I'm going to have to quote you on this. I'll get your name later. It is a crucial issue. It is an issue that, if we position it back where I work in the EU, can be answered more easily than in an American context, because we have public universities only. And what we've been doing over the last 8-10 years is uniting in major networks that function as lobby groups. And there, the American example of CHCI was very inspirational. We started with just faculties and organizations, and then the research university created their own LERU, the League of European Research Universities, which is the sister organization of the Russell Group, which is the sister organization of the Ivy Leagues. And so they are very much in contact. But for all the other public universities, we created the European Alliances for Humanities and Social Sciences. And it's a massive lobby group that basically has an office in Brussels. And they push. I can't do that, I'm not much of a lobbyist, but they're really very, very good. They write white papers, they advise. Then we're not getting very far. But at least we have, contained some of the cutbacks, but the cutbacks are really very, very painful. Much more difficult, of course, in a North American context, because universities are massive private organizations, although I understand that there is a lot of contacts among levels. There is no other way than to go and talk to the people mm-hmm. who think that we are worthless and say, actually, you know, with all due respect, look at all the things that we've done. We have to engage with this because it's not going in the right direction. Also with this new administration, clearly, somebody really thinks that we are a luxury product, that we are a finishing school for the demoiselle of the 19th century. So I think we in Europe, we're very aware of the problem, and there are champions of the humanities, Germany, massively, really defending it, Finland, Scotland, as opposed to Britain, and the south of Europe, out of habit and tradition and a certain form of absolutely understandable nationalism, and the Greeks and the Portuguese holding on, as they should, minority cultures. So the issue of languages for us is absolutely crucial because we're a multilingual space. I don't see any other practical way to do it. The more theoretical one would be, indeed, a discourse about the potential for growth of the humanities, what we can do in this phase. Thank you for an impossibly complex question.
Good morning. Thank you so much for being here. I'm in the History of Science and Medicine program. I'm a student. I'm just beginning to investigate your work and also the work of Alfred North Whitehead. And I just wonder of Alfred North Whitehead. I wondered if what promise process metaphysics has for posthumanism, and if you could speak to that at all.
Fantastic question. You're in good hands, clearly. Lovely. Process ontologies, process metaphysics, and the posthuman read with the vital new materialism are really cousins. They are great allies. Work on this already exists, and you're probably very aware of this. Isabel Stengers has been the flag bearer of the Whitehead connection, and read with Deleuze, and she has done amazing work that Latour has profited greatly from and quotes quite rightly. That trend is now spreading a little bit. I've been so into the bringing in the studies and feminism into the Deleuze field that I have neglected, but I will go to the Dewey and the James from now on. I'm convinced that it's one of the things that I need to look at. One very interesting area where this is being done is again Scotland, Dundee, where the work of James Williams, Process Ontology and Language or something, it's just a book that is just sent out. It's just absolutely on this. Looking at Wittgenstein, looking at the different allies. And the strategy is the same. It's a tactic to say to the great institutions of philosophy, you know, the resources are already there. We don't have to revolutionize and storm the philosophy department. We should just go back to the tradition and create new alliances, create new assemblages. And I think recomposing the analytic continental distinction, European Anglo-American distinction, is definitely for your generation the task. We got really bogged down into the transatlantic importation of post-structuralism and what that did to the French theories, and both here and back home. It was some sort of a short circuit. It stopped the process. We kept it going in different ways, but then we have to go back to some of this. I think it's a moment now to recompose. I would really put all my trust in this, looking forward to what you'll come up with. It's very important. these are your students coming up, yeah?
Thank you so much for your insights. I just wanted to ask a question as a student who's currently grappling, actually, with my position and connection to the lifestyle that I'm choosing, and especially the great text to which I'm indebted. So I just wondered how you thought our thoughtfulness could, and maybe even this commitment to a life lived in the innermost essence, could actually radicalize our studies of justice in the abstract and also justice in the concrete.
I'm not sure I understand the question. How you can radicalize studies of justice?
Justice in the abstract. Or
so you are in a law school? Is it, was it, no, in general.
I'm a historian of science, or an aspiring historian.
Okay. Well, it's a crucial question. It's the question that leads me to stress the issue of ethics. And of course, choosing to say, which I tried to say as clearly as possible yesterday, that it is the ethics that must guide our politics, is really disagreeing tremendously with the entire Marxist front that would say exactly the opposite. And I think we have here the Hegelian Marxist Spinozist divide, which is very, very strong in contemporary political discussion. It's Badiou Deleuze, if you wish. Zizek, although I don't take him seriously, because he's not serious, Deleuze. It's an old discussion, but I think for me, the aspiration to justice is what we need to keep alive in our own practice at a time when STEM models of research are even promoting a certain idea of the posthuman. And I would see it as an aspiration, that is to say, as a passion, as an affect, that has to inform the creation not so much of norms but protocols of behavior. I would be very pragmatic. Deleuze is always saying we don't need legal codes. He's a Frenchman, so he's bound by codes of law. In Europe, we have Roman law codes. I think we need jurisprudence. We need the cases and the case histories and the pragmatic cases. So justice is an aspiration that can be implemented pragmatically. It's what we absolutely need to keep it going. It is officially in the ethos of everything that we do, but it is cast usually in a neo-Kantian universalist mode that gives you very, very pre-made compositions of what the human is, of what justice is. It's all pre-played in a sense. And if you come in with differentiation, but we are missing people, then you tendentially, and things have improved, get dismissed as a relativist. That's why in the paper I insisted this is not relativism, it's perspectivism, which is a term that we can get from Leibniz as well as from Spinoza. It's grounded perspective. It does make a difference. If you are an indigenous, a black, a working class, it makes a world of difference. To what? To your ability to self-represent your position in relation to your practices. That's why subjectivity, positionality are the issues that we bring in. We need a differential approach to justice, multiple forms of justice, transnational land justice, which would put a lot of our even scientific practices at risk, the collection of samples, or human remains in museums. These are serious issues, and they're not just human rights, because that human is a dodgy category. They're fundamental, I would call them aspiration to affirmative togetherness, that we can actually look at each other in the eye with dignity and know that we've done the best by each other. That would be the aspiration to justice. That's where Spinoza, I think, is a phenomenal figure.
Thank you so much for this wonderful conversation. I would like to go back to the point that the humanities are shrinking. And I was thinking, isn't the death of the humanities allow for the birth of the post-humanities? And I'm saying this because I often find myself when I am in a humanistic center where the point is that often humanism goes very well with anthropocentrism. And I often have to clarify why, when we study the humanities, we need to study the environment, we need to study technology, why we cannot just study the human for the sake of the human. And I find the death of the humanities kind of in the self-fulfilling prophecy of Foucault. He already said in The Order of Things, 1966, that the problem with the human science is that the subject and the object are the same, and basically it's an autopoietic mode. So I personally find some joy and almost like this Nietzschean amor fati in the idea that as the death of God allow for the birth of the human, the death of the human allow for the birth of the post-human. And I think if maybe the idea that the humanities are shrinking is because we need now the post-humanities, and we cannot study anymore the human just through the human, for the sake of the human, in the history of the human.
Fantastic moment of Nietzsche, more Nietzsche than Spinozist affirmation. And I understand where this is coming from and where it's going. I think NYU, where you teach, is one of the places that, like Sweden, Linköping, that would embrace the post-humanities with zero nostalgia, with zero sense of loss of the tradition that they didn't feel was adequate ever. And I think we have to accept that that differs tremendously. A place like Utrecht would never do that. Our tradition is too old, too ancient, too dear to us. The humanities, the law school, the theology faculty, they are the core of, I would say, of Dutch culture. We don't dismiss it as quickly as that. These are the famous, this is the point of different degrees of disidentification and letting go. We have to accept that different institutions, different countries would deal with it differently. And it doesn't really matter so long as we mutually respect where this is going. So that would be the first thing to say, that taking the jump is probably clever, and I'll say in a minute why I think it's a good move, but I wouldn't want to let the rest go. The risk is, and this we have this in Utrecht very clearly, not sure about a complex place like Yale, the risk is that the tradition becomes a museum, that you become a museum of yourself, that you self-replicate in the mode of this is what we will have been, i.e. what we have already ceased to be. That is my fear. I think that our canon and our classics are too important to just be museified. I think they need to be activated for the present. Just to lock them away as, oh, this was the great old culture, doesn't do them justice. They are texts for today, but we need to allow them to be contaminated by the present and not to be purified in climate-controlled archives, which is a little bit what we're doing, certainly in Europe. Why do I think it is a good move to have post-humanities centers? Because if we don't, the corporate sector is going to do it, to cut a long story short. The environmentals and the digital humanities are massively supported by our industry, by the banking, by the financial sector, and by public support. Everybody wants the new generation of gadgets and the new whatever they do, what generation of iPhones or whatever we're at, or the next Alexia and home robot. We all want that. Consumers' economics is behind it. So I think in some ways what I was trying to say with the post-humanities, I say this is actually already happening so much. Digital humanities is already a world of its own. And they call themselves humanities. They could have called themselves something else. They deliberately didn't, i.e. they are setting themselves up as the humanities of today. Then there is the humanities of yesterday. Now, this is a very dangerous position to put ourselves in. So very well done for the institutions that take the jump. And I know many in Barcelona, there is one led by a cyber professor who is also going to say post-humanities. And for them, it's a reaction to Franco and the difficulties of purifying the humanities from the long legacy of fascism in a country that was under fascism for so long. So I think you almost would have to go case by case. What I admire about your work is the affirmative way in which you can embrace the Nietzschean transmutation of values and go with it. And you really go the whole hog to the cosmos with it. I am maybe generationally, but also maybe pedagogically a little bit more careful. And I'm so attached to the great texts of the philosophical tradition that I would actually miss them. And I know that you will take them with you in your transmutational leap. But by the end of it, there may be quite a different story. So this would be a case where I would settle this end to see where we're going. But great that some major humanities faculties are going where the corporate interest is, and they're saying, what exactly is the human in your humanities? Can we have a look at it? Which is exactly what you do. Great that we're there. We need to be there. It's only a question of time before they call themselves the real humanities and shut us down. That's my sense. Of this.
So I have what might be a sort of a different way of asking a question that might lead to a differently, potentially grim answer, which is that in history, the favored adjectives maybe 10 years ago became very quickly, and now maybe aren't anymore, about scale, temporal and geographical scale, so big history, deep history, global history, yeah.
all of a sudden had the backing of universities, of departments, and of Bill Gates. Millions and millions of dollars being funneled into that project. Historians doing a kind of amateur geology, right, the sense of the long time scales. All of a sudden, Jared Diamond was something legitimate to read again in the history department. It was assigned to me in my intro to the profession course at Princeton in my first year, and now never would be. So there was this, maybe we're already beyond that moment, but I wonder if any of you would speak a little bit more explicitly to this question of scale, temporal or geographical, just because it seems like a moment where that's one direction that some of the digital work is going. But as we've seen in the wake of the election, an alternative move, the move back to the local, right, to the community, something that kind of rejects the sort of techno-hideousness of social media, even as it's been used, right? Think to the Arab Spring and the use of Twitter in 2012, and then think to online cyberbullying and its use expertly by Trump just in this last year. We had this such a tortured relationship to the technologies of globalization that I wonder if there's a way to unite the program that you've given us with a sense of the dangers, but also the potentials of not just using every scale, so not just saying the local, the regional, the national, and the global, but putting our feet down in one of them and saying this is the one where we think the best political and ethical work can happen.
Do you want to come in on the scale? Because you have a little bit...
Well, I mean, so this is an ongoing conversation, but what I would say, and something that I have thought about, is in these efforts to rescale, in particular in the realm of temporality, perhaps we need to make a first step to say, to ask what are the ways we can perhaps use some of these canonical texts and critical theory to ask what is temporality more generally? What is scale more generally? So I'm interested not so much in writing a deep history or a big history or using science to sort of show how, what really happened to who really is the original, indigene, but rather to ask what are the ways in which ideas about temporality come to play in and activating technologies. So it's a different way of kind of amplifying what you've been saying or concretizing what you've been saying about there's an important move there, especially for people who have a confidence in moving between this illusory boundary of jargon and jargon, or technical language and technical language, to sort of reflect and consider what are the tools that we are using to construct whatever scale we're working on, and understand how those, what the human that's built in. So when we talk about self-assembly, or when we talk about the networks being able to correct themselves, we should never forget that they were created by humans, and we should always understand what's happened there. And when we got the question about, or the comment about Yiddish being jargon, I was reminded also of the term glitch, which is also Yiddish. Yes, and there's a very good, right? There's a very good reason to believe it. To slip and fall is what it means, like slip on the ice and trip and fall. And so that glitch, those moments that we want to ascribe just to the kind of haywireness of the machine, are actually deeply embodied, felt human sorts of moves that we can understand in the way we make sense of our large-scale system. So,
you also very welcome. Practical level, I know, I mean, you were interested in really in research programs, but on a level of different lifestyles, it has been said that the day after the Brexit decision in England, the young English student woke up and said, oh, and now what is with my Erasmus study in Italy and my Erasmus study in France? So I think there was a disconnect, so to speak, in lifestyles between a broadly academic intellectual world, which is globalized not necessarily in an economic sense, but in a whatever other sense, and I would also say, as you said, a kind of return. What happens in the moment is a weird form of the return of humanism, of humanist categories
of
this country
and
in Europe. And these are two cultures who begin to drive, you can't really see that they live in the same world.
Well, there's all kind of mutual contamination. Just a little answer on this. It's absolutely fantastic level, plateau of thinking. And that connects back to some of the questions yesterday about spirituality and religion. One of the great strengths, particularly of philosophy, if you do it with a materialist, godless, in a sense, creature like Spinoza, is that we have a long tradition of thinking about eternity, really a long tradition. And if you secularize it and ground it materially, and you make it part of a discourse about embodied brains and embrained bodies, and you connect it to the question of memory, which Spinoza does and Deleuze even more, memory and the imagination, what would be the factors of a posthuman relationship to eternity? Is the fact that your computer files can outlive you the index of eternity? And is it apersonal? And we could connect it to the discussion on the immortality of the soul and all of that if we wish, not particularly, but I would connect it to Deleuze's and Blanchot, for instance, the discussion on death and what remains. Mm-hmm. What remains? Mm-hmm. And according to Spinoza, what remains is the impact you've had on the world. What you will have been in the modes of relation in the world, that remains. And that is your eternity. That only affirmation returns. It's the eternal return, where's Francesca? The eternal return of positive difference. And I think that is an incredible sort of dimension that we could explore at times where people have such a reductive understanding of the scale of our existence, with forms of nihilism that are so rampant and usually feed the right-wing populism, the decline and nihilism, when in fact there are openings here. But again, philosophy would have the resources to structure that discussion, but our secularism, at least in Europe, has been so enormous that we always get a little bit edgy reopening those chapters. That's why I think that the post-secular is important here. We have to revisit this. And if we are technologically enhanced, this cryonics that Francesca so believes in can make us immortal, well, we have something about eternity here that we need to, 1,000 years of non-linear history, personal as well as collective. So it's a whole new horizon out there.
So I stepped to the microphone thinking I would ask a question, but that was such a brilliant ending to this session that I think I will not. Okay. Thank you so very much, Rosie.
Thank you,
Rüdiger. Thank you, Joanna.
Thank you, guys. Thank you. I want that book. Yeah. Thank you.